So good morning, in fact, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rahul Khatri, and right now I am with DuPont, working there as a technical manager. And before that, I was with Moser Bayer, one of the, I would say, pioneers in module manufacturing in India. And I've been in this industry for 9 years now. So in the last session, in fact, it was a very good session, and then we talked about a lot about the kind of risks that you would associate with solar power projects that have been built up in India and that would be built up in India. And then we talked a lot about the PPAs, contracts, and other issues, but nobody actually talked about the module quality issue. I'm not sure actually because, and if they think that the modules which you're installing would work for 25 years, that is good. But coming from a manufacturing background, I can say that it's one of the biggest risks that you can associate with any PV power plant. And again, people talked about tariff, which is reducing at a very, very rapid pace in India. And again, surprisingly, there were no concerns around that. But when I heard from Mr. Vikas, and he told that maybe 22, 23 cents might not be possible, and this statement is coming from one of the biggest module suppliers in the globe, I believe that that is a cause of concern because, and I also believe that since because we have an oversupply situation in China, and then there are multiple manufacturers there, someone would come and then offer modules at that price as well. But you don't know what they're going to use. And if you are going to use something which is unproven in the field, which is cheap but unproven, then the risk will increase manifold. And why you actually, so how these low quality modules or modules with unproven materials get access to markets? So one of the main reasons is that the standards that we have, and Mr. in fact, I guess Chetan, you talked about standards, the quality standards that we have, how good IEC are in terms of evaluating lifetime of PV modules. So I would be talking more about that because, so DuPont, besides supplying materials, we are into a lot of applications. PV is one of the biggest application for us. And so as far as existence is concerned, we are in this, in existence for more than 200 years now. And in PV, we are there for more than 40 years. So materials is our bread and butter, but as far as PV is concerned, besides material, we try to understand the reliability and the lifetime of PV modules as well. We conduct field studies, we can do a lot of different accelerated tests to see how we can better simulate outdoor conditions. So I will be talking more about that. So I know we have time constraint, but I try to cover maybe 10 slides in the next 5 to 6 minutes. So this is actually a kind of question I ask everyone. I frankly say that I typically get a very, very, I would say, doubtful response because people want their modules to work for 20 years, if not 25 years, but then I don't think they are sure that whether they're going to work for 25 years or not. And we talked about assumptions in the last session as well. This, I believe, is one of the biggest assumptions that is being right now dialed in your financial calculations, which is 0.7% annual power degradation. And when you talk about anything which has to work for 25 years, you have to kind of maybe do some risk mitigations. And the risk mitigation methods that we typically take include warranties, tier one, and certification. So I won't be talking about warranties and tier one because that is something more about kind of a piece of paper that you can get. But I see certification is one of the, I guess, physical ways where you can actually test modules and see whether they are good enough or not. But then we talked about the limitation of IEC. And I will give you some few examples of, and then demonstrate why IEC is not doing the job that it is supposed to do. So you can see here, so this is a report from TUV. As you can see on the chart on your, in the chart on your left-hand side, the module issues, the module defects have increased over time. And this is actually a case study, which now I believe a lot of people know about. So this is a kind of a backsheet which is used in the module. So this something was introduced around 6 years ago. A lot of people, including tier one suppliers, use this backsheet because it was a cheaper backsheet. And DuPont did an analysis on this when this was in the field for around 1 year. And we did show that when you kind of magnify the backsheet, you will see some cracks. So we did publish a report on this as well, but people still continue to use the same backsheet. And after 4 to 5 years in the field, in a lot of cases, including India, now there are very serious cases in this, failure cases in this backsheet. And again, the learning for us is that, one is that if you're going to use unproven materials, the risk is there and they can fail. And since we don't have robust standards, so something like this will pass, will get the ISO certification, and will be used by the developers. So in terms of the limitation, so I will just spend maybe 1 or 2 minutes on this. So right now, if you look at IC in terms of the stresses, they are using the right stresses. They are doing damp heat analysis, which include your temperature and humidity. They are doing UVA, which is your ultraviolet radiation. And then they are doing thermocycling as well. But the issue is that there are two issues. One is that they are doing all the stresses on individual modules. Whereas in actual scenario, the stresses will act simultaneously on the modules. Second issue is that as far as UVA and thermocycling is concerned, it's kind of under-tested as per IEC standards. And this is something a lot of studies, including Dupont, has done an analysis on UV. And then if you look at this, the fourth row on that table, so if you simulate or extrapolate IEC testing, it will only be equal to 70 days of outdoor exposure. That too from the front side. They do nothing on the back side. And if you do calculations, then you will see that because there's a reflection of light from the surface, there will be on an average 12% reflection. And your batchet also would be exposed to UV. And there are a lot of third parties also have done this kind of analysis, and they also tell that you have to do UV on the backside as well. And if you have to maybe simulate it for 25 years, then so right now current IC standard says 15 kilowatt hour per meter square, but then based on the climatic conditions, it can be anything between 171 to 275. So you can see that how much UV is under tested in IC. So what we recommend that do the same test, increase UV and thermocycling exposure, but do all the stresses on the same set of modules. And then when we did this thing, so you can see this is something which we think that would be good enough at least to test materials which have been used in modules for 25 years. So it's a kind of a sequential test. It's not actually an individual test, but a sequential test. You have damp heat, you have UV, you have thermocycling. In terms of stresses, conditions, they all are same, but just that we have now going to do it on the same set of modules instead of doing it on individual modules. And just to show that how good they are in terms of simulating outdoor conditions. So we have some data as well. So the data on the left hand side gives the results of the testing that we have done. So we call it module accelerated sequential testing. And data on the right hand side is field data. So data which has been taken from the field. So you can see a very close correlation. So we are seeing cracks in the back sheet in PVDF. In mass test, similarly, you can see similar cracks in the field as well. In terms of polyamide-based backsheet, the case of which I shared with you earlier, again, you can see a very close correlation. So this shows that this mass testing is performing very well in terms of simulating outdoor conditions. And there are some other examples as well. I will just skip this slide so you can see, again, very good correlation from what we saw in the field and then what we saw in the lab testing. Based on this analysis, we did analysis on materials which are there in the field for maybe 5 to 6 years, but still not shown issues, maybe a large scale issues. So for example, something like PVDF based backsheet, they are in the field for now 6 to 7 years. They have started to show issues in the field, but then they've still not shown mass scale issues. But in the mass testing, we are seeing a lot of issues in this backsheet. So kind of gives you an indication because we could replicate the same in polyamide-based batchsheet, which I have already failed in the field. We think that PVDF is also going the same route and is very high likely to fail in next few years. Similarly, we've done something on different backsheets. This is something also we have seen in the field. Again, this is something we did. So it's more of a kind of a combined test when we are combining UV and then temperature and humidity. And then you can see something like this. And you will see, so we have also seen, again, similar effects, similar issues in the field as well. So again, the summary, the objective of showing this slide is to actually how we can improve our existing quality check procedure, how we can upgrade the existing IC standards. Right now, people are doing 3x of IC standards, but still, it does not make sense because it's not been done properly. It's not going to simulate outdoor conditions. So we have to do something. So for doing something like this, you have to do a lot of field studies as well, which we have been doing since last 5 to 6 years. You have to get data from the field, see what kind of issues you are seeing in the field, and then try to see how you can simulate similar issues in the field. So this is one way of maybe improving your module quality, but another way is to use something which is already proven in the field. We talked about backsheets, so something like Tedlar-based backsheets are already there in the field for now 30 years. And then again, Mr. Chetan was telling about modules which are performing in the field for more than 30 years. And I can be very sure that all those modules would be having Tedlar-based backsheets because this is the only backsheet which is there in the field for more than 30 years. No other backsheet has more than 10 to 12 years of field experience. So this is what I wanted to show, discuss. So this is about DuPont. I've already discussed this with you in terms of what we do. And definitely I would like to discuss more about how we can improve quality infrastructure, I guess, in India, because we are definitely seeing a compromise, I would say a more compromise on quality, maybe in future. So how we can plug that thing? So government is doing, at least taken an initiative to kind of have this policy. I'm not sure what they're going to include in it, but at least it's a step in the right direction. So we'd be happy to discuss more about this topic in next few minutes.
Thank
you for your time.
Thanks. I request Sujoy. We are running short of time, but Sujoy, who's the first solar CEO in India, they run a different module technology. I would like him to speak.
Very good afternoon to all of you, and thanks to Anand and his team for putting together this sessions. Thanks, Mr. Shrivastav. I would like to just very briefly touch upon two themes which have resonated in the session so far. One is innovation, and the other one is reliability. First Solar is a thin film photovoltaic module manufacturer, and our technology is very different from what comes to us from the polysilicon world, because we don't use silicon in our modules. Ever since the late 80s, people have been researching to use alternate materials, alternate semiconductors to alternate silicon, basically to exhibit the same electrical characteristics, which is light falls on the material and it produces electrons. We, as a company, started research with cadmium telluride, which is a binary mixture of cadmium and tellurium. We produced our first module way back in the mid-90s. Company went commercial in the late part of 90s. We had a very successful IPO, and today we have about 3 gigawatts a year of annual production. Part of it in the US, part of it in China. Part of it in Malaysia. We don't have any production in China for a variety of reasons. Most importantly for IP issues, and because the technology is highly patented. The innovation comes to us because the manufacturing process is extremely different. We use glass as the primary material, coat it with a very thin layer of semiconductor. There's a lot less of material which is used for the same watts as compared to silicon. And then we cover the module with the second piece of glass to give it mechanical stability, seal it, and the module is done. So the manufacturing process is very different. It does not have any of the upstream processes around silicon refining, wafer, cell manufacturing, and so it's very fast. But it's also a continuous process, right? The positives of this is that all our modules are alike. So there is no grade one, grade two, different bill of materials. It all comes from the same source. So if we have a problem, it manifests itself across the fleet. But then there is a lot of consistency in the way technology is produced. And this holds good for other thin film technologies too. There have been a lot of misconceptions around thin films, which we keep getting from our customers, especially people who are not familiar with our technology. The most common ones are it's inefficient, it's toxic, and it's less reliable. The fact is that, yes, when thin film started, thin films are essentially second generation photovoltaics. And so when it started off in, let's say, the early part of 2000s, The production cost was lower as compared to poly, simply because the processes are different. But the yields, the efficiencies were also lower, the conversion efficiencies. First Solar, just as an example, we've invested over $1 billion of R&D into improving the efficiency of our technology. And today, our commercial product, which is available across a 3 gigawatt volume, is just under 17% conversion efficiency, right? So in terms of area per acre on a ground mount, you know, you can install thin films today at the same acres per megawatt as you would do for polysilicon. But then we also believe that conversion efficiency is really not very relevant when you look at cost of energy. You need to look at real world operating performance. And that comes from how the semiconductor behaves when it's subject to variations in temperature, variations in the quality of light, variations in the angle of incidence of the light, because all these efficiencies which manufacturers like us and others on the panel publish are at standard test conditions. And what's important is when you deviate from standard test conditions, what happens to that efficiency? And the reason why innovation happened in PV and people went for second generation materials is because these materials have a slightly more robust characteristic in terms of degradation when they're exposed to high temperatures. Also, they respond relatively better to polysilicon when they are exposed to low quality light. And these are things which are proven. And so what happens is, as solar deployment happens between the two tropics, where it's very hot, where it's very humid, and the light quality is not that good, you would see thin film technologies, whether cadmium telluride in our case, or CIS, which is the other thin film technology which is popularly available, produce more energy for the same installed capacity as compared to silicon, especially in hot climates or hot and humid climates. And that's what innovation does in terms of innovating on the primary semiconductor material. Just as a point of reference, we've improved our conversion efficiency at about 3x that of polysilicon in the last 4 years, right? Polysilicon cell, record cell, we're talking record cell to record cell efficiencies as published by NREL. Those of you who are interested could go to the NREL chart and see how the efficiency curve has progressed for monosilicon, polysilicon, and thin films, and you would see the rate of growth is a lot more in thin films, simply because there's been a lot more innovation happening on the primary material side. Toxicity is the other thing which we keep getting. We use a cadmium, there's a name called cadmium telluride, and cadmium, as all of us know, is toxic, but cadmium telluride is a binary material, and it is not cadmium. It's as different as hydrogen and oxygen and water, the analogy. So when you fuse hydrogen and oxygen, you get water, which is stable, non-flammable, whereas elementary hydrogen is extremely volatile. Similarly, elementary cadmium is very different from cadmium telluride. Plus, we use a lot less material. We just use 12 grams of semiconductor cadmium telluride in a module which weighs 12 kilos. And so even if you crush the module, break it, there's no way you would get cadmium out in the atmosphere. We've got tons and tons of research paper, including one done by IIT Delhi, which demonstrates that these are environmentally safe. And kind of the proof of the pudding is that we've got installations in Japan, in the EU, in the US, and all these countries have fairly more stringent EHS safety regulations as compared to the current safety regulations which we have in India. Moving topics to reliability, very favorite topic for us. Rahul spoke about the accelerated testing of PV modules. Since our manufacturing is continuous, we have the as I said, all our modules are alike. We have the ability to pull modules off from production line at a random and cycle them through these tests, these accelerated life cycle tests, which we've been doing for the past about 6-7 years now, right? IEC, and we all agree, is not the ideal measure because it's a one-time test and there is no connection between what you produce and certify at IEC versus what you produce in real-world operating conditions. And as an organization, we take reliability very seriously. So we've worked with companies like TUV. They have these long-term sequential tests, Thrasher tests. These are protocols which are far more stringent than the bare minimum IEC requirement. And then we also worked with the SGS and defined what's called Atlas 25, where you take all these tests, which Rahul talked about, and operate the module for a year. And the same module is cycled through these harsher environmental conditions in an accelerated environment for a year, and it has to hold to the levels of degradation which the manufacturer warranties. Because I think in the end, it's not so much about the efficiency, but it's about real-world operating parameters, and also about long-term reliability. And, you know, I mean, we're proud to share with the audience here that IIT Bombay and NREL did a study in India. They sampled PV modules installed in India over a period of 5 years, starting from 2010 to now, across multiple technologies. And cadmium telluride actually got the least degradation in that list. The study is available in public domain for those of you who want to go and research it. But again, I think long-term reliability is where developers would lose or make money. And so it's very important that reliability standards are properly ensured in not just the specs, but also the regulations, right? And I think MNRE has taken the first baby step of at least coming out with an equivalent IS standard. But really, the next step would be to have random sampling in Indian laboratories and then have Indian laboratories certify and test modules which are meant for installation in India. That would really set the bar for people to stop dumping, you know, obsolete technology. Lastly, I would like to just comment on what Chetan said about, you know, developers losing money because of technology. But it's the developers who select the technology, sir, at the end of the day. So if you are, you know, not sure about where to invest your money, and you don't do the diligence, then, you know, developers should not blame somebody else at the end of the day, right? You know, warranties have to be enforced properly. You need to have contract mechanisms which allow you to do that. And, you know, I mean, so it's fine, but then, you know, nobody's forcing developers to go and buy low-cost or low-quality equipment, right? If they're knowingly buying it, then there's something wrong with the whole process. With that said, I'll give it back to Mr. Shrivastav, open for any questions later on. Thank you.
First, solar has many features, but they have a secret sauce. They can compete on price. So at any price, solar modules come, I think they can compete. That's the secret of success.
we can compete on cost.
And I'm saying, right, in addition to what
today's
you said.
Market, we believe price is lower than cost for some of our companies.
Is it? Okay. So they are committing harakiri. Okay, that's not your problem. So I have only one caution to those who are investing in solar. As an owner, each owner has a limited capacity to grow, unless you have tons and tons of money channeled forever for you, which doesn't exist. So having said that, if you want to grow beyond a point, you have to be a utility. And if you want to exit to a utility, you should have a good quality hardware installed. Otherwise, it'll be discounted price. So don't imagine that putting compromises, you are going to get valuations from others. They won't. They're not throwing money. So I just thought to caution you that. But a very small point on warranties is when you transition from one owner to the other, there is a little challenges on that. That's a separate issue. I don't want to discuss. It's not technology. That's something. So I invite Rohit from REC. Actually, I was a little confused, but now I know about REC. I visited your place.
Thanks. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Rohit from REC. We are better known as REC Solar in Europe and other parts of the world. So there's always a confusion about REC being Rural Electrification Corporation. And I also studied at an REC Regional Engineering College. So it took me 14 years and I'm back to square one. So anyway, they are coming to the agenda. I think we are talking, the session is focused on technology. And I'll be very brief about why REC, comes in, hands in glove with technology. Like, to give a brief introduction, we are a 20-year-old company, fully integrated player. We are starting from polysilicon to solar module manufacturing. We do everything in-house. We have two key locations for manufacturing. One is Norway, where we do our polysilicon manufacturing and a wafer block line, which is about a gigawatt. And the second location is Singapore, which is again starting from, where we get in the polysilicon into Singapore, and we do the wafer block slicing and cells and modules there. Now, if you look at any industry, there are basically two approaches to the industry. One is you become either a technology player or you scale up on volume to compete. So if you go the China way, it's, gigawatts and gigawatts in solar. You know, the smallest player there might be talking about a gigawatt, and the biggest is 9 gigawatt. So, if you're from Trina, I know I'm not holding back there. I'm not, nothing wrong about that. There are two approaches here. Now, REC takes a technology approach, and I have been with REC for 5 years. When I joined REC in 2012, we were manufacturing modules of 225, 230, 240 watt modules. And what we are offering today is 345, 350 watt as a standard product, and in a 72 cell, and up to 295 watt in a 60 cell configuration. Now, the key point here is we are still on a multi-crystalline, or a polysilicon platform. And we are achieving wattlesses almost, equivalent to mono perc and better than mono. So now, from a technology perspective again, I think we should look at being a technology agnostic. Sujoy just spoke about First Solar. They are again one of the technology leaders with a different material. And you have Solar Frontier in Japan. So there are many companies sitting in different parts of the world, and there are many companies in China also that are doing a fantastic job today. Now, how different REC here is, what we offer to the end customer at the end of it is, if you look at what are we doing with the solar module, we are generating energy. So, the key is how much are you generating and how much are you paying for it. If you look at REC power plants anywhere in the world today, I'll talk more about India because I have, we are more focused on the Indian market. But the lowest, performance ratio we have seen with our plants is 82%. For a well-engineered and a well-managed power plant, we have seen, even for a rooftop installation, we have seen 82%. And for a single-axis tracker-based, it has gone beyond 84%. Now, this, this in short talks about what we deliver to a customer. And the second part is basically the reliability aspect. Reliability is basically, we have a global, warranty claim rate less than 50 parts per million. And I take pride to say that in India, it's even better. I have never had a backsheet complaint. We have probably almost maybe 70-80% of the manufacturers in India have faced backsheet complaints, or maybe all. You don't have the data, but yeah. So for REC, I can say we have never seen a backsheet failure in India. We have never seen a PID failure with REC modules. You don't need to negative ground your inverter when you're using REC modules. Now, if it comes to rooftop installations, you're using string inverters which are isolation based. They're not using isolation transformers. So you actually have to spend more money to get a separate equipment from the inverter manufacturer if it is available, and then do a negative grounding. With REC modules, you get 100% warranty without using negative grounding solution here. So, another factor I'll talk about reliability, this is basically on low warranty claims. Then we talk about degradation. While we offer the same warranty as most of our competitors, we actually have been, we go beyond manufacturing, as most of the technology leaders would be doing. We have brought in modules from the field, tested them at third-party accredited labs. And, for a Rajasthan location, we had a 3.5-year-old installation, and the actual degradation over 3.5 years for 5 modules was just 0.68%. So this is the kind of degradation we talk about, and this is this comes with 100% consistency in manufacturing. We have imported over 200 megawatt of modules into India till date. which is fairly small as compared to, you know, a lot of our counterparts. But considering the premium positioning we have, this is a very decent number. We are probably the largest module manufacturer in India with a European lineage. So I can say that except for two customers, nobody has ever been to our factory for a pre-dispatch inspection. We have had many customers who have come to our factory just to visit our facility, but nobody has even come and done a random testing of our modules. So that is the kind of consistency we, you know, bring about here. So this is just a gist about REC. We have a good setup in India. There are a lot of interesting, you know, discussions. You know, someone, you know, gentleman here mentioned, do we have the manpower, right? So now these are things which we cannot change overnight. It takes time. So that was one of the key things which I did when I took over the Indian operations for REC. Instead of starting off with sales, the first person I brought into my team was a technical person. You know, the key here is basically there are hundreds of new players coming into solar. You know, and especially if you look at the rooftop segment, in utility scale, when you have a target to do 200, 500, a gigawatt of installations, you can scale up on the manpower, you can bring in the skill sets, you can send them abroad for training, you can do a lot of things. But look at the people who are, you know, small EPC players, installers who are doing a 5 kilowatt, a 10 kilowatt, a 100 kilowatt, a 200 kilowatt, absolute startup. So this is where we come in. We work with the partners. We have a global program which is called the REC Professional Program. We train the partners, we handhold them, we do site audits. So today I have two technical guys in my team and just three sales guys. And we have partners who have been with us for 5 years. Even if they do maybe 200 kilowatt a year or five, you know, maybe a megawatt a year, they just sell REC. And the customers they have sold to, they only buy REC. And they have been with us for, you know, my first customer was February 2012. And this customer is still with me, and I have sold 5.5 megawatt to him in 5 years, and I'm going to get a 5 megawatt order in the next 30 days or 40 days, and there will be no competition there, you know. Any, you know, so that's the kind of way we work in the Indian market. We also adopt the same ways, you know, quite similar to what you know, Sujoy was mentioning. We do rolling reliability tests. We pick out random modules. When we develop our product, we work at twice the IC standards. And when we talk about innovation, we have, you know, been at the, not just at the, when you talk about efficiency, we have been one of the industry leaders. We have also brought down the temperature coefficient of polysilicon to newest levels. We are at minus 0.36, which is one of the best. We are the first company to, you know, commercialize poly PERC modules. Mono PERC modules have been, you know, available for a very long time. We launched our first poly PERC module in January 2015. We are within 18 months, we launched the third generation of that product. And I can assure you, our product development team is working on, you know, a lot, many other products. Like in the 12-month window, the product development team developed 27 types of modules. So that is the, you know, there's a huge amount of money which goes in. We collaborate with Ceres in Singapore. We work with, you know, university in Australia. So there is a huge amount of effort on that side. And so, you know, if you start, you know, if it, so just to summarize, you know, if you look at it from starting from polysilicon to our interface with the customer, be it our EPC partners or our developer partners or the end customer, we work very closely. We understand the whole cycle of this business. And we are evolving every day. It's not that, you know, we know everything. Every day is a learning day. You know, we learn something new, we evolve and, you know, get better. Thank you so much.
Thank you. There's a common theme here. Reliability on a long-term basis. I just want to mention that I worked as advisor to a couple of companies at some point in my life. And when I suggested them that we put rooftop and it can work for 15, 20 years, they laughed at me, literally laughed it away. And it took me a long time to convince one or two of them that it makes sense. And eventually they went on an OPEX model saying that I don't want to believe in the lens. Let somebody else put the money. Yeah. So I think that's a driver. But Now having module, I just thought to mention that now we have completely different.